Hi, so good evening, everyone. This is our concluding part of our lecture, three-part lecture series on Indian philosophy. I want to thank NLU Delhi Philosophy Club, and in particular Vineet, once again for inviting me. And thank you all to who've been participating and who've been present. So in today's lecture, we'll be discussing the heterodox schools of Indian philosophy, classical Indian philosophy. We haven't discussed the modern Indian philosophy that includes a great deal of socio-political philosophy that deals with reinterpretations, revivals of previous schools of thought. This introduction to Indian philosophy has mostly been under the ambit of classical Indian philosophy. So the division that we had made in the beginning was between the six Astika schools and the three Nastika schools. The six Astika schools being those that believe in the authority of the Vedas. And in doing so, they either take up certain elements of Vedic teaching or they develop parallel schools of thought that do not contradict or are in conflict with the Vedas. But as we have seen in our previous discussions, there's a great deal of internal conflict between the different schools of thought and even the ones that do believe in the authority of the Vedas. So to quickly recap, the six Astika schools are put in pairs because a justification of knowledge. So the six Astika schools in pairs are Sankhya Yoga, Nyaya Visheshika, and Purvamimamsa Vedanta. Before I continue, Abhineet, have you let in all the people who are in the waiting room?
I don't think that there is anyone. We don't have a waiting room function here, right?
Right, because it shows there are 10 participants and on the top there are only 4 names coming up. So I just wanted to clarify this with you.
I think you're seeing only the panelists. That is why that's it.
Okay, I understand. All right. Sorry for the digression. So the six Astika schools again being Sankhya Yoga, Nyaya Visheshika, and Purvamimamsa Vedanta. The three Nastika schools, which we will be covering today, are the ones which do not believe in the authority of the Vedas. They develop their own schools of thought that do not need validation or agreement with anything from the Vedic or Upanishadic teachings. And these three are the Charvak school, which is the materialist school, Jainism, and Buddhism. So we will be covering them in this very order, Charvak, Jainism, Buddhism. And after each, we'll take a short break because there will be a great deal of terminology and information being shared. So the Charvak school is one of the oldest schools of thought known in Indian philosophy. And unfortunately, we don't have any existing texts on it. So what we know about the Charvak school is mostly through the commentaries of others, especially the Vedantins, Madhvacharya, Adi Shankara, Vallabhacharya. And their commentaries on the Charvak school, they seem to be very pejorative quite often. We don't exactly know how accurately the school has been represented. So anything that we learn about the Charvak epistemology or Charvak metaphysics, we have to take with a grain of salt. That is a bit of a disclaimer. So one thing that is clear is that it is a materialist school, and being a materialist school, it does not accept anything that is immaterial to be part of its worldview. So the soul, karma theory, afterlife, God, anything that is immaterial that cannot be reduced to the material world of elements, of atoms, is rejected. As a materialist school, it clearly seems to fly in the face of the prevalent metaphysics and epistemology time, and as such is quite radically different from the other schools of thought that we have covered so far. It's a very, very old school of thought. It's referenced in some of the earliest epics, in the Gita, in some of the early Buddhist texts. And in fact, by some accounts, the teacher of the gods, Brihaspati, taught the Charvak metaphysics and epistemology to the asuras, the demons, so as to ruin them via a bad metaphysics. This is an ingenious way of critiquing a school that you don't agree with. So as a materialist school, it believes that all that is material. And it explains phenomena such as the consciousness via material workings as well. So bodies, senses, objects, consciousness, they're only the different combinations of elements. But the consciousness, which seems to hold a special status of its own, is explained as an epiphenomena. And epiphenomena means it's a byproduct of certain phenomena. So the example given is that the way fermented yeast leads to an intoxicating quality, the same way the different combination of elements in the body lead to this byproduct, which is the consciousness. This view, which may seem a bit simplistic and is thus called the Lokayata school as well for holding an everyday view of metaphysics, is not far different from the way modern philosophy of mind considers the mind to originate from the workings of the brain. So there is a proto-scientific materialism in the Charvak school, and a lot of what it seems to present in a simplified form, modern science does take it up in its own materialist underpinnings. So coming back to the epistemology of the Charvak school, the metaphysics is one that is materialist and that denies anything that is immaterial. And its epistemology is one of pratyaksh alone. We discussed that there are six different forms of pramans that are accepted in Indian philosophy, starting with pratyaksh, which is perception, anuman, which is inference, upaman, which is comparison, anuplabdhi, which is non-apprehension, arthapatti, which is postulation, and shabda, which is testimony. The Charvak school considers pratyaksh to be the only valid source of knowledge, and the rest are either reduced to anuman, which is inference, or considered to be invalid sources of knowledge for they do not, something like shabda, testimony, for they do not allow one to have access to reality directly. It's always mediated through someone else, and then you go into an infinite regress as to how you can justify the authority of someone else. So this one aspect is taken up in logic about how inference connects the propositions of the premises to the conclusion. But what the Charvak school has to say about that is that in inference, you're simply making a leap. You're jumping from the given to the unknown. This is also taken by the Western philosopher David Hume about in his theory of causality, about how we see constant connections between two things. If I push a billiard ball, it flows forward. We see the connection between the two action, and we believe that there is a causality between the two. The critique given here is that if there is actually causality, then the effect must be contained in the cause alone. That from the cause alone, you should be able to deduce something about the effect. Otherwise, what you just see is a constant connection, and there is no necessary connection between the two. Hence, there is no such thing as causality as we typically understand. There are certain paradoxes that come up in this worldview, because if you deny causality, then everyday existence and everyday sense making seems to be put under suspicion. So what does the Charvak school have to say about motion, about causality? We simply do not know, because there aren't enough texts. There's not enough direct information available. Only indirect texts are available. A work that was completed in 2011 by Ramakrishna Bhattacharya looks at other minor texts to say that Anuman is in fact accepted by the Charvak school, but only if it is derived from Pratyaksh. So denying Anuman altogether, or denying inference altogether, which is considered to be representative of their epistemology, of the Charvak epistemology, is considered to be incomplete, because the view that Pratyaksh is the only valid means of cognition is in itself an inference. It's an inference from the working of one particular form of praman versus the others. One can say that any idea formation depends upon some level of inference, because an inference is the step in logical reasoning that goes from premises to conclusion. And if you deny inference, then even the statement that Pratyaksh is the only Praman cannot be justified. So that is a representation of Charvak epistemology. How much of it is correct? It's a bit hard to say. We know about certain characters from the Charvak school, such as Ajit Kesh Kambli, but what exactly did they have to teach, we do not have information on. So as a quick recap, the Charvaks are materialists. They deny anything that is immaterial. Since they deny the immaterial, their worldview of how one should live one's life is hedonistic, that human pleasure is the only goal worth striving for. They're represented as having a very base or vulgar understanding of hedonism, that it's one where even if you're in debt, you should only eat ghee. And these are some of the statements made about Charvak hedonism. But whether it was truly that or whether it was something like Epicurean hedonism, again, we do not know. Epicurean hedonism is one where there's a distinction made between the higher pleasures versus the lower pleasures, the pleasures of the mind versus the pleasures of the body. We know that the Charvak view holds hedonism as the goal of human life, but whether it's only base hedonism or whether there's a distinction between the high and the low, again, we do not know, unfortunately. The brief interesting thing it has to say about liberation is that death is the only liberation. So the moksha or the overarching soteriology is completely absent. There is no karma, there is no afterlife, there is no God. This is the life that you are given. Death is the only liberation, and enjoyment is the only purpose of living. The only praman accepted is pratyaksh, and that is considered to be paradoxical because that in itself is an inference. So the Charvak school is, by all respects, not very well received by the other schools of thought. Before we move on to Jainism, I want to take a short break between each of these different schools because as the terminology from the next takes over, we don't want to lose track of the former. So are there any questions?
Yeah, please raise hands if you have any questions, please. Yes, Professor Jasper.
One minute, please. Asad, question is, though that is again a sort of question paradox within the question. The idea is, when we talk of Charvak as a philosophy, and when we are aware of that it is already been compiled by the persons who are the critics, basically, then how much it is relevant and how much we can rely on the logics they are discussing in reference to that what is there in Charvak or what is not?
That is the problem of it. It's as if because there are no primary texts, we are left to only study it as a historical footnote rather than a school of thought. So it is often misrepresented. The book by Ramakrishna Bhattacharya is, in my opinion, the only source that we have of what Charvak views might be. It does try to show that in certain minor texts, because Adi Shankara, Madhvacharya, they are some really major figures in classical Indian philosophy. Their word is taken to be more, closer to the truth. But in certain minor texts, one finds distinctions between high and low pleasures, between certain statements that point towards a belief in Anuman from Pratyaksh. So since we are left with guesswork, it's really hard to say that we can ever really study the Charvak school as a philosophy. It's most like a historical footnote. So that is a problem there, absolutely, sir.
So only, I mean, my issue is only this, that while reading, so I realize one thing, that the critics somehow, which in contemporary times look like fitting to our, our intuition or to our mindset, so therefore we are picking it. So that critique, which is critique of their times, may suit such, so therefore we are in a position to appreciate that. But the things which is not suiting to them at that time, so they had not included said that, so therefore in while discussing Charvaka's philosophy, that thing is missing, which is actually can be traceable in context of Charvaka.
Yeah, absolutely. So, we do know about certain things, like they were very critical of the ritualism of the Brahmanic priests in the Vedas. So if they were critical of certain ethical problems that they saw in other schools, then would they not have an ethics of their own? Like, I believe they would. We just, all these other critics seem to gloss over that fact that if they are critical of someone else, they are likely to have an ethical system of their own.
True.
Yeah. Right. So thank you for that, sir. As we move on to Jainism, I want to share my screens to put up a symbol that we will be decoding. A symbol that was agreed upon by all the Jain sects in 1974 as representative of Jain faith. And we'll use that to springboard forward to some of the main concepts in Jain philosophy.
I think we had one more question.
Oh, right. Yes.
Edie, you wanted to ask a question?
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
So my question is that Charvak, there are three schools, right, of heterodox paradoxical thoughts, that Charvak, Buddhism and Jainism. Mm-hmm. So Buddhism and Jainism developed as major recognized religions, mm-hmm. and they are even followed now. Why is it that Charvak did not develop as a religion, apart from the fact that it is just historical footnotes, we do not have much source on that. But apart from that, why did it not develop at that time?
I believe in materialist schools and hedonist schools, there is a general inner resistance to religion building, or they usually develop like communities, like the Epicurean communities. They were mostly communities of friends who would get together and celebrate the higher pleasures of life together. Because they don't have a complicated metaphysics, there is no uniting worldview beyond just simple hedonism, simple cultivation of one's skills. I mean, here I'm talking more about Epicureanism in ancient Greece. The cultivation of one's virtues and spending time with one's friends. The concept of friendship is very, very important in Epicureanism, and how it's conducive to living a good life where one can cultivate one's senses, one's intellect. But because there is no complicated metaphysics, there is no general worldview of salvation, the concept of salvation itself is rejected. The problem is not that how are we to find freedom in after this life or in the afterlife, but how are we supposed to make the most of this life? It's in a way very different from the problematization of life, the way it takes place in other schools of life, in other schools of thought, sorry, that if life is problematized and salvation is to be sought, here the problem is that there is no such scope for salvation. The problem is that the salvation is not to be found outside of life, but whatever can be maximized, whatever good or pleasure can be maximized, has to be done within life. So that is not very conducive to dogmatism, to religion forming. And as such, the hedonist schools, wherever they have arisen, they mostly form small communities of like-minded people rather than, begetting followers as of such.
Can I make a bit of observation here, though that's an historical observation more? These schools actually are not in a position to develop themselves because of one more reason, that is assimilation of the Hinduism as such. When we pick Buddhism and Jainism as such, so they were in a position to develop because they are counter-revolution to Hinduism. So they were following their religion. They are completely different from Hinduism. So that is also the paradox, that in contemporary times we pick them as Hinduism, whereas they themselves are not terming themselves as Hinduists. Yeah. So if you call Jainism or Buddhism, they themselves never figure it out, or they want to figure it out themselves in Hinduism as such. So I mean, when they are picking themselves as Hindu, they were in a position to do so. Buddhism and Jainism, they were in a position to build themselves as a separate religion as such, keeping in mind that they have started characterizing themselves into various principles which they are in a position to carry. Mm-hmm. Whereas in the case of Charvakas, they were quite small in numbers, small in community. So therefore, with the passage of time, they started assimilated within the Hinduism itself. It means with the front runners Hinduism. A reason one more is that the suppression of dissent even in that times. Mm-hmm. So there is a historical record that the moment you will start having, I am forgetting the exact term in reference to dharmashastra, I mean some sort of a public discussion was going on. So the way that discussion used to happen, sometimes it end up in violence. Mm-hmm. And this, with the passage of time, lead to the conclusion that it's better to assimilate rather than being withered away or vanish away with the help of violence. So this is also one of the reasons that with the passage of time, Charvaks, we hadn't seen their philosophy develop to that extent. There is no written source available from them, and with the passage of time, that had vanished.
Oh, that's a very, very important point. The assimilating your opponent is a much more effective strategy than trying to fight them.
True.
Yeah. Right. Abhineet, can you enable my screen share so that I can share the symbol? I can also show it via my phone. That's not a problem. But I would like to put up the symbol so that...
Oh, sorry, I was muted. I'm so sorry.
No.
Do you not have the screen share option as of yet?
No, it says it's disabled for participant screen sharing.
Wait, check now.
Right. Yes, perfect.
Yeah.
Right. So this symbol, can everyone see the symbol?
Yes, we can.
Yes. Right. So this symbol was agreed upon by all Jain sects in 1974 as representative of the Jain faith. It includes some of the major concepts used in the Jain faith and some concepts of the Jain philosophy as well. But I wanted to decode this symbol together before we move on to some of the more abstract, some of the more purely theoretical aspects. So in the symbol, one can see this peculiar shape of this image, and it's supposed to represent the lok, or the different realms in which all existence takes place. So this small symbol, this small semicircle at the top, this is the Siddha lok, where the Tirthankars, the freed ford makers, who help people cross the river of birth, death, and rebirth. This is where the Tirthankars, or the liberated souls, they live. They are the highest points of reverence and belief in the Jain faith, even more so than the gods. The gods are also trapped within the cycle of rebirth, but it's the Tirthankars who are liberated. Mahavir Jain, who's supposed to be the systematizer of Jain faith and starts the Jain faith as a religion, was the 23rd of the Tirthankars. But in a classical understanding, there were an infinite number of Tirthankars before Mahavir Jain, even though he's considered to be the 23rd one. In the Jain cosmology, the world is supposed to have never been created, and it will never be destroyed. That existence has always been a fact of life, and that those who are able to achieve salvation and achieve freedom from karma are able to enter this Siddha Lok as Tirthankars. This area is the Devlok, and the gods who are reborn because of their good karma are found in this small Devlok over here. This larger tapering area is that of the human realm, and this much larger tapering section is of the Nark, or of the realm of the hell beings. So this particular shape is often shown even as a body or a embodied human personification in certain Jain iconography and temples. But this shape is supposed to represent the Devlok, the human realm, and the much wider Nark, in which those with bad karma will be reborn. The symbol here, the swastika, its four ends represent the four forms of rebirth that can take place. The first is of plants and animals. The second is of humans. The third is of the Dev, the gods. And the fourth is of the hell beings. The three dots here, they represent right faith, right knowledge, and right behavior. They're also called the three jewels of Jain faith. The open hand representing peace, representing a lack of malevolent intent. In the center is inscribed Ahimsa. In Jain temples, there's frequently found the Sanskrit inscription that Ahimsa is the highest religion. And the Jain faith is one that is led by an ethics, and the metaphysics and epistemology seem to be, in fact, secondary to the ethics of it, both in the everyday practice of it as well as the religion. And this Sanskrit phrase over here, parasparop graho jivanam, it means that all life is bound together by mutual support and interdependence. So this symbol shows the Jain cosmology. It shows the focus on Ahimsa, the interdependence between all creatures, the different forms of rebirth that can take place, and the three jewels of the Jain faith, which is right faith, right knowledge, and right behavior. In Jainism and Buddhism, like in the Astika schools that we have covered so far, there's a similar belief in knowledge being the only path to liberation and ignorance being that which binds us. So the word Jain comes from the word Jinnah or spiritual victor. The spiritual victor is that which is that individual who can remove all karma from their soul. So the Jain faith has a particular, has a unique view on karma. It's presented almost like a substance, like an atomistic substance that is present all over the universe. And both good actions as well as bad actions attract karma to your soul. So karma is not simply a law of moral causation, that there are certain effects that take place and they lead you to a pleasant rebirth or an unpleasant rebirth. But they're actually simply these atom-like substances that attach to your soul based on your actions. So it is said that good karma and bad karma, they're both chains. Bad karma is like chains of iron and good karma is like chains of gold, but they both bind you. So it is only the Tirthankars who are able to remove all karma from their souls and as such achieve liberation. The next important concept to consider is samsara, which is the endless cycle of life and death. Karma leads to samsara, and the freedom from the karma particles, so to say, is what will bring about liberation and make one join the Tirthankars in the Siddhalok. Ahimsa is the most important path to removing karma from your soul. Ahimsa is not just an ethical doctrine, but it's also the metaphysical path to salvation. And the five Mahavratas, or the five great vows that the monks and nuns take to do not steal, to not covet property, to not covet material wealth, to not lie, all of them, they're all secondary to the number one injunction, which is of Ahimsa, which is of absolute non-violence to all creatures. There is no privileging of one creature over the other. That all creatures deserve Ahimsa, a treatment of Ahimsa towards them. And the monks and nuns who can practice this in the extreme are the most capable of removing karma from attaching to their souls. And moksha, which is the final removal of all karma from the soul, is what is liberation. Now, the metaphysical and epistemological terms that are of importance here, I'm going to name them first so that you can keep them in mind. The metaphysical term is anekantvad, and the epistemological term is syadvad. Anekantvad is also called the many-pointed doctrine. The many-pointed doctrine of the infinite complexity of reality, and because of which there is no single viewpoint that can ever be said to be representative of the truth. There is this pluralism in reality, in apprehending reality, which according to certain interpretations is an extension of Ahimsa itself. That it's an Ahimsa towards worldviews. But that's a minor interpretation of it. It is a form of pluralism. It is a form of relativism. The metaphysical side of the coin is Anekantvad, and the epistemological side of the coin is Syadvad. But more on that in a moment. Anekantvad is represented and explained through this analogy of five blind men who go to who walk up to an elephant and touch different parts of it. So the blind man that touches its tail thinks that this creature is like a rope. The one that touches its belly thinks that it's like a wall. The one that touches its ear thinks that it's like a fan, so on and so forth. And there is one person who is able to see, who tells them that none of their views in themselves were wrong based on the relative position that they held. That's the important part. The whole concept of absolute truth is made secondary to the relative fact that we begin any discourse or any understanding of reality from a relative position. And whatever information that we have from that relative position has a relative truth to it. As long as we qualify any of our statements with, relatively speaking, this is the case, then that is a statement that contains a certain amount of truth. So the sixth individual who is able to see and tells the five blind men that their different views put together would actually represent the elephant is a representative of a Tirthankar who has attained true knowledge because of liberation. So the only individual who is able to attain true knowledge is the one who is able to remove all karma from their soul and understand their soul as the pure jeev, as the pure source of all intrinsic knowledge. And that leads to what is called Keval Gyan. Keval Gyan is only available to the Tirthankars. It's only available to the liberated, the mukt soul. The jeev, which is the innermost soul, it's not like the Atman per se, but like the Atman, it contains perfect knowledge in the Jain school of thought. The jeevs are innumerable, as many beings as there are. That's the number of jeev that also exist. Each jeev takes the shape of the creature that it inhabits. So the jeev of an ant is like the size of an ant. The jeev of an elephant is like the size of an elephant. But they inhabit all of them. And it's through rebirth, through reaching the human body that finally self-consciousness is able to act upon the different forms of ignorance in the world and find that that karma is something that is to be freed oneself from, and then one can attain enlightenment. But because the other jeev, the other creatures aren't able to reach that point yet, they don't have the higher mental faculties. So there is an added level of compassion towards them, that they are not only bound to existence, but they're also doubly bound because they don't have a higher sense of intellect that they can understand the nature of karma and how to free themselves from it. So, like the Atman in the Astika schools and in the Upanishadic thought, like the Atman, the Jeev, in its pure sense, has absolute intrinsic knowledge. Removal of karma, which leads to an understanding of the Jeev, leads to pure knowledge, pure Keval Gyan. But before that, any statement of truth, any claims to truth, any proposition has to always be qualified with what's called syat or relativity. This position of relativity is key to Jain philosophy, that from any position that you have, you are given a certain amount of context, and based on that context, you can make a claim. And since that context will always be limited, your claim always has to be qualified, that that based on this or conditional to this position, can I make this claim? The metaphysical doctrine is called Anekantvad, and Syadvad is the epistemological side, that all knowledge is probabilistic, that all knowledge is qualified, it's relative. So the two together, the combination of Anekantvad and Syadvad, say that reality is infinitely complex. It is real as well as unreal, permanent as well as temporary, momentary as well as not momentary, etc. An example of this is, if you think of a substance called Dravya, then a substance as pure matter can neither be created nor destroyed. this is also from a view of physics, that matter cannot be created or destroyed. But if you see the different modes that it can inhabit, the different shapes that it can take, those can be infinitely many. So the same object from the point of view of substance is permanent. From the point of view of modes is infinite, or is it can be temporary, it can be constantly shifting. So what position you hold, from what point of view you're looking at something and making a truth claim, that depends, that determines the nature of that truth claim. But the moment you say that your truth claim is the absolute truth, in that moment you are committing what's called the naibhas, or the fallacy of ekantvad. Anekantvad, or the multiplicity of reality, the many-pointed doctrine, is the nature of truth. And ekantvad, the fallacy where you take one statement and believe it to be representative of the whole truth, that fallacy is called an ekantvad or naibhas. The naivad are seven different positions that you can take for any truth claim. These are the enumeration done in the Jain epistemology. So, for example, vyavhar nay is where only particulars are considered to be real. Sangraha nay is where only universals are considered to be real. Riju sutra nay is where only the momentary is considered to be real, for example, in certain views of Buddhism. But if you take any of these views as the absolute view of reality, then you're forgetting that there might be, and there likely is, another point of view from which that can be denied. So an example given is that of substance. As dravya, as pure substance, it is neither created nor destroyed, therefore eternal. But as a mode, the different shapes and forms and qualities that it can have, from that point of view, it is infinite, and it can be temporary, it can be momentary, and so on and so forth. A criticism, a very popular criticism against the Jain metaphysics by Adi Shankara, is that the different points of view added together cannot give the whole truth. So the example of the elephant is one where the different blind men can never realize that it's an elephant by adding together their different relative truths. And it's only the Keval Gyan of the Tirthankar that is able to apprehend the reality in its absolute sense. But this criticism is literalizing an example, which is meant to say that it's not just related to an elephant, it's related to any kind of aspect of reality, that it will always have certain elements that you cannot apprehend, because even the simplest of substances has an infinite amount of attributes. To explain this, I want to take an example from the French deconstructionist, the post-structuralist, Avinit is smiling because he knows who I'm about to talk about, Jacques Derrida. His concept of difference is one which also explains this phenomena, that for any concept, its meaning is arrived through difference as well as deference. So, for example, a cat is understood because it differs from a dog, from a camel, and so on and so forth. So the number of things that you can make it differ from are infinite. So it is a difference from that which it is not. And also there is a difference as to how much information you can add to it. Now, if I was to say a sentence like, I saw a cat, you have a certain image of that proposition in your mind. If I say I saw a cat on a Monday, then more information is added. I saw a cat on a Monday and it was raining, then more information is added. So it is to say that for any concept, in the view of this French deconstructionist, the meaning can always be differed from something else, and it can always be deferred by more information added. And as of such, there is no singular apprehension of any concept. It's always in a process of deconstruction because of its infinitely many attributes. And in the Jain view of reality, the many-pointed doctrine, which is Anekantvad, and its view of epistemology, which is Syadvad, which is the doctrine of probability or sevenfold judgment, you find a similar move being made, which is that for anything with its infinite amount of attributes, it depends on what position you hold before you can make any judgment on it. So Adi Shankara's critique of the elephant example seems to literalize a particular example used, which also shows the limits of language, that it's you're using a an apprehended object from real life, but the point is that we are all like the blind man. We're all only apprehending certain attributes of it. So to do a quick recap, karma is like a substance that attaches to the soul. Karma, good actions and bad actions both cause karma binding. The freedom from karma binding is that which leads to liberation. The liberated beings reach the Siddhalok where they join the Tirthankars. And the Tirthankars are the ones who are prayed to, who are looked up to, not the gods. The gods are simply reborn because of their good karma, but don't have a particularly privileged position. They may have been individuals with certain virtues, and because of that, they're able to be reborn in the Devlok, but they may be reborn eventually in the Nark if they don't remove the karma from their souls. So the view of karma is a bit unique in the Jain faith. Ahimsa is the highest religion. Ahimsa is the path to removal of karma from your soul, and the five main vows that are taken by the monks and the nuns. It's also interesting to note that in the earliest mentions of the monkhood and nunhood in the Jain faith, there were more nuns than monks recorded at several points in history. So whatever may have been the socio-political, the cultural elements leading to that, but there have been an equal or greater amount of Jain nuns than there have been Jain monks, as a side note. The metaphysical doctrine of Anekantvad and its epistemological corollary of Syadvad, they present a relativistic and pluralistic view of the world, where any position that you take has to be qualified by Syat, and for any praman, for anything to be a praman and not simply a nyaya, which is the relative position that one can hold about particulars, about universals, without making it out to be the absolute truth. For any nay to be a praman, it has to be qualified by a syat, which is that it is an acknowledgement of its relative nature. If you consider any relative position to be absolute, you fall under the fallacy of naybhas, which is that you believe that you have apprehended from your relative position any kind of absolute truth. And with that, we conclude our section on Jainism, and we'll be moving on to Buddhism. So I would encourage you all to ask me any questions or clarifications before we move on.
Yeah, please, if you have any questions, please raise your hands. And thank you, Asad, for mentioning both Epicurus and Derrida. I mean, while I was listening to your Karvak Charvak section, I was, you know, the entire time, I was like comparing it mentally with Epicurus philosophy. And when you started talking about Jainism, I mean, I had heard of this elephant story before, but I did not have an idea about how layered this thing is. I mean, it's fascinating that they apprehended like so many themes that that Western philosophy only so later discovered.
It's fascinating how that philosophy, it deals with the currency of ideas, and as of such, it doesn't adhere to a typical sense of, you know, linear chronology of time. That since there have been the human capacity for reason, there have been the capacity for these great speculations.
Yeah, please, if anyone has any questions, please feel free to raise your hand or unmute.
Yeah. Good evening, sir. This is Sarvagya again. Sir, I wanted to, I think this comes from a postmodernist view, and I just noticed this in Eastern culture and some of the Western cultures too, in particular of these philosophies like Jainism. Mahavir Jain was taken to be the last Tirthankar. We see this pattern also in the Western philosophy, like in Islam, Prophet Muhammad is taken to be the last messenger of God. So do you think that there is some socio-political angle to it, so that nobody after them can be given or regarded with the same amount of respect or that same kind of pedestal that they are raised to? Is that kind of a socio-political angle given to it by their followers, or what will be your suggestion or comment on this?
That's a very interesting point. in the case of, say, Islam or Sikhism, there is a self-appointed or a follower-appointed sort of conclusion to the last leader, the last guru, the last the last prophet. But in Jainism, I don't believe Mahavir Jain called himself to be the last Tirthankar. He happens to be the last Tirthankar, but the belief is that anyone can achieve that status. The Siddhalok is not restricted in that sense. It's just an extremely difficult task to become a Tirthankar. So in Jainism in particular, like in Buddhism, there is no barring to who can become a Tirthankar. Like in some other religions where they might say that, oh no, this person was the last guru or this person was the last prophet. For whatever reasons, as a consolidation of the religion, as a solidifying of a tradition that may have predated the religion, there's always a very interesting history of religion and what all contemporary views it might unify, in fact, while it forms a religion. Like, we have to remember that at the times in the past when these religions were being formed, they were always competing hundreds of religions that may or may not have been able to establish themselves in the same way. So whether any school of thought was simply isolated and developed its own metaphysics, its own epistemology, versus how much it may have taken on from others, that is a very, very subtle reading we have to do of the history of religions and the philosophy of religion. But in the Jain faith, like in Buddhism, there is no barring to who can become a Tirthankar, who can become a Buddha. In Buddhism, in particular, an example that we talked about earlier, and I'll briefly mention it now and we'll take it up again shortly, is the Buddhist teacher Lingji would teach his students via this koan being a riddle by which the journey of a follower is tested and their way of apprehending the teachings is tested. So the koan or the riddle was that if you see the Buddha on the street, you must kill him. That's a very bombastic sort of statement. But what it's meant to say is that the moment you apprehend a Buddha outside of you, you have put someone on a pedestal. You have believed that it is an act that takes place outside of one's own capacity. And this misapprehension is leading to false notions in your own mind. So to say that you have to kill the Buddha on the street, it is to say that you have to kill the idea of externalizing Buddhahood in your own mind. That it is to be absolutely achieved within yourself. That you have enough understanding of reality via the Buddha's teachings, that you can apply them to your own life, that that intellect has to give way to pure experience. And this pure experience is that which you can seek out by yourself. So I'm sorry, I gave a very long-winded answer to your question, but in conclusion, in Jain faith and in the Buddhist faith, there is no such barring to who can achieve that status. And this is, in fact, quite a unique feature of both.
All right. Thank you so much, Sai.
Are you also in a position to comment that why Buddhism has not developed the way it had developed in China or rest of the world, like even in Japan?
I am not entirely aware of the historical developments that led to that taking place. That is something that I'm also very fascinated by and I intend to look into. But what I know from some preliminary readings is that there was a great deal of conflict between the Purva Mimamsika teachers like Kumarila Bhattacharya and Prabhakara, and the coming of Vedanta and the kind of sway that Vedanta held during and after the Bhakti movement. It kind of changed the tide of belief in India. I mean, the Bhakti movement was also one that was reacting to the Brahmanical nature of Upanishadic teachings, where it was Sanskritized, it was only allowed to certain castes, certain privileged individuals. So the Bhakti movement also was one that used bhakti and devotion as a means to salvation, and was able to incorporate a lot of, you know, everyday people and devotional groups. So the Bhakti movement became extremely popular And at the same time, the metaphysics of Vedantic, the upcoming Vedantic schools and Purva Mimamsa became popular. So it just seems to have made the Buddhist teachings that had been popular hitherto somewhat take a backseat. And meanwhile, they were consolidating in Southeast Asia, in Burma, in Sri Lanka and all as Theravada, in Tibet as Vajrayana, and in China and Japan and Korea as Mahayana. But if there were other socio-political events and movements that led to this seeming disappearance out of India, what they were, I'm not entirely sure. The only one that I'm aware of is that the Bhakti movement made some of the interpretations of Vedic mythology and how Bhakti can lead one to freedom be extremely popular amongst the common people in India. That popularity really took a huge, huge section of India by sway.
Also, if I remember correctly, Ambedkar also hints towards it in his revolution and counter-revolution in ancient India. I think the account that he gives is that when there was the Muslim invasion of, you know, Arabic invasion of, you know, northwestern India, basically places that were strongholds of Buddhist culture like Gandhar and, you know, all these places, they were actually, you know, they were under Arabic control. And a large-scale conversion happened over there, and you know, it was basically because all the people who were of the Buddhist faith got converted to Islam and all that. I'm not exactly sure of the details or the reasons that Ambedkar gives, because it's been a long time since I read that. But I think that is the trajectory that Ambedkar takes in explaining the disappearance, at least from northwestern India.
Right. No, that's an interesting point. It has a plausibility to it. It's important to know. It's a very interesting history of how it went from being the dominant faith to perhaps its strongest points had been incorporated, also assimilated so much so in the what we now call the Hindu faith, that that there were these divisions being blurred and the socio-politics were being won out by one over the other. Is one that flows directly from the Four Noble Truths as understood by Buddha. The Four Noble Truths are dukkha, that there is suffering, dukkha samudaya, that there is a cause of suffering, that this cause being that if a cause is present, the effect arises. This is going to be very important shortly, because one of the main metaphysical concepts, the pratitya samudpad, comes out of the second noble truth of the dukkha samudaya. The third is the dukkha nirodh, that there is cessation of suffering. So dukkha samudaya, that there are causes for suffering, and dukkha nirodh, that there is a cessation of suffering. If the cause ceases to exist, then the effect will also cease. And in these two, the dukkha samudaya and dukkha nirodh, out of these two arises the pratitya samutpad, which is the doctrine of dependent origination. I'm just again sounding out these phrases so that they're familiar when you come across them again. They are some of the most cryptic, some of the most complicated concepts in Buddhist metaphysics. Pratitya Samutpad is in a way the fountainhead of all understanding of samsara, of nirvana, of truth, reality, of true experience and the like. Right. So the fourth noble truth is dukkha nirodh gamini pratipat, which is that there is a way leading to the cessation of the suffering. And this way is the middle path. The middle path is also called it also leads to the noble eightfold path. And this noble eightfold path, it on the surface seems to deal with right living and cultivation of certain qualities, but the later interpreters of the philosophical implications of the Buddha, especially in the Abhidhamma Pitaka, which I just mentioned, the third Pali basket, they take great metaphysical conclusions out of this notion of the middle path. So we will briefly touch upon one of the greatest interpreters of this middle path, who is Nagarjuna of the Madhyamika or Shunyavad school. So when Buddha mentions the middle path and how it leads to the noble eightfold path, that includes the right faith, right resolve, right speech, right action, right living, right effort, right thought, and right concentration. this Eightfold Path is meant to be a practical realization of certain truths, not simply an intellectual realization. The Buddha stressed upon experience much more than intellectualized, much more than intellectualization. The path to knowledge that will remove ignorance is one that cannot be simply achieved through thought alone. It has to incorporate a certain amount of cultivation of certain virtues, and as of such, the metaphysics, the epistemology, and the ethics are very much intertwined. The ethics in some of the Astika schools become secondary in nature or corollaries of the metaphysics, but here the ethics lead the metaphysics and epistemology. This is a defining feature of both Buddhism and Jainism, that ethics are not in the background but are in the forefront of the philosophical view as well as the religious faith. I mean, calling Buddhism a religious faith is a matter of how history has taken it. But again, when the Buddha was teaching his realizations from his enlightenment, there was a monkhood and order of monks that he stressed upon, but not a religious formation. This religious formation takes place after the Mahayana Sutras elevate Buddha to a level of a god or a true reality. The Mahayana Sutras, which come after about 300 years of the Buddha's death, they are now very much in that conflict and appropriation mutually with Vedic thought. So one is influencing the other, one is adopting the other, but they're both happening at the same time. The Mahayana Sutras elevate Buddha to almost like a god and abstract his different qualities to represent different layers of reincarnation and so on and so forth. So the Buddha as simply a being who points out liberation that is easily, but that is potentially achievable by everyone, that is in a way appended by a much more complicated metaphysics, but in which the new goal is the highest goal that one can strive for is not just one's own individual liberation, but to become a bodhisattva that aids the liberation of others. So Nirvana, or the achievement of one's own liberation, is individualistic in the classical or in the original Theravada Hinayana, which is used to be called Hinayana. In the Theravada interpretation of Buddhist teachings, the search for Nirvana, the path to liberation, was individualistic. But in the Mahayana Sutras, it becomes a much more metaphysically complex process in which the Bodhisattva, or the one who is able to attain enlightenment, them helping others attain enlightenment as well, is the highest goal of an individual. So the goals, the belief systems, the main texts, the sutras which are accepted and the ones which are rejected, these start to form great divisions between the different sects of Buddhism. So even within the Theravada school, there was a distinction between the Sautantrika school and the Vaibhasika school, where the former completely denied the Abhidhamma Pitaka, saying that those are not the Buddha's words and they are just interpretations. They are leading one into metaphysical inquiries, which the Buddha was always himself against. That the Buddha always stressed upon practical realizations, but the Vaibhasika school and other Buddhist sects in the Mahayana school would also say that right knowledge is not self-evident, that it does require some philosophical speculation. But in the Buddha's own words, when he was asked the 10 famous metaphysical questions about whether the universe is eternal, whether there is life after death, whether the enlightened being continues to exist or whether they cease to exist, the Buddha was famously silent on these questions, because for him they were not conducive in leading to liberation. Right. So the second and third noble truths of Dukkha Samudaya and Dukkha Nirodha, that there is causes for suffering and that these causes can be made to stop existing, they can cease to be. These two together form the doctrine of dependent origination. This doctrine is called Pratitya Samutpad, and it is the fountainhead of a lot of these great interpretations of what the middle path really is, of what the nature of suffering has to tell us about the nature of liberation. In fact, the later Mahayan interpreter of Buddhism, Nagarjuna, in 2nd century CE, goes so far as to say that samsara is nirvana. And to understand this very complicated term, one has to understand Paritya Samutpada a little better. So, in the Buddha's own words, this wheel of dependent origination has 12 links. And the 12 links all begin from ignorance. That it is ignorance which causes desire, and desire which causes clinging onto the world. So similar to Jainism, similar to some of the Astika beliefs, one of the very common themes in Indian philosophy is that it's ignorance which binds and it is knowledge which liberates. Whether that knowledge can be understood via the intellect alone or whether it requires practical experience, some schools differ in how they approach this particular notion. But another common theme is that direct experience is privileged, direct intuitive experience is privileged over the workings of the intellect alone. That the intellect is seen to be limited and that certain absolute truths are only to be realized via, say, meditation. In Mahayana Buddhism, for example, let me find out the exact numerology of it. In Mahayana Buddhism, the pure experience is explained via 4 meditations or dhyans, 3 samadhis, and 10 stages of bodhisattvahood. So meditation is not presented as a simple phenomena at all. It's a very complicated procedure, and it's a method of transforming the intellect into pure experience. Because the intellect is not, in Buddhism, it's not seen as something that can lead one to a certain point in knowledge, and then it's to be abandoned in favor of direct experience, the way one finds in Upanishadic teaching. Their intellect is still given some kind of value. But in Buddhist teaching, the intellect is often seen as something which misleads from the beginning. That the intellect itself has to be transformed into direct experience. That the intellect limits one into the world of phenomenal experiences. And phenomenal experiences are all, they are all based on dependent origination. By certain cause and effect relationships that make this completely momentary, completely dependent, completely conditional nature of all reality appear to us to be permanent in some sense, or appear to us to be true in some sense. This concept of dependent origination is indeed one of the most complex notions. But in the Buddha's own words, there is a 12-linked cycle or 12-linked chain of the causal wheel, and it goes as such. Why do we suffer misery, pain, old age, and death? Because we are born. Why are we born? Because there is a will to be born. Why should there be this will to become? Will to be born exists before even birth. So this willing is presented in a very unique sort of sense, that it's not that you are the subject that is doing the willing, that the willing is happening because of the nature of dependent origination itself. So this is a very paradoxical way of understanding desire, because we think of desire as embodied in the body. But as we will explore very shortly, the Buddhist view also includes the doctrine of anatta, that there is no such thing as the self, that there is simply the willing, and there's simply the action without the agent behind the action. So to return to the 12 links, why are we born? Because there is a will to be born. Why should there be this will to become? Because we cling to the objects of the world. Why do we have this clinging? Because we crave to enjoy the objects of this world. Why do we have this craving, this thirst for enjoyment? Because of sense experience. Why do we have this sense experience? Because of sense object contact. Why do we have this contact? Because of the 6 sense objects. The 6th being the mind, and the other 5 being our sensory objects, sensory organs. Why do we have the 6 sense organs? Because of the psychophysical organism. Why do we have this organism? Because of the initial consciousness of the embryo. And why do we have this consciousness? Because of our predispositions or impressions of karma. Why do we have these impressions? Because of ignorance. and thus ignorance is the root cause of all suffering. So ignorance is something that is beginningless, the same way Maya in the Vedantic school is without a beginning. The ignorance is that which sets forth all desire, and the embodied self can break through this desiring activity that ignorance brings forth. But despite this embodiment, there is no such thing as the self behind it. I mean, a way of understanding it is in a simpler way is via the Western philosopher David Hume's bundle theory. So David Hume says that when I try to apprehend myself, all I understand or all I see, all I perceive is a bundle of sense perceptions, a bundle of ideas, fleeting ideas that change from moment to moment. I don't apprehend a self behind them. I have the apprehending quality where I can see the different, the bundles of sensory perceptions, of ideas. But how does that synthesize to make a stable self? There is nothing in sense experience or in consciousness that explains that. So in Buddhism too, this is explained via the five aggregates or the five skandhas. This is known as the Sanghatavad theory, that like the Western philosopher David Hume much later says that I only see a bundle of perceptions and ideas. The five skandhas are rupa, that the form of material images, vedana, sensations, samagya, perceptions via discrimination between objects, samskaras, mental tendencies of opinions, and vijnan, which is consciousness. There is a lot of enumeration that is done here because this is the way Buddhist teachings have been taught. So just bear with me. The particular terms don't matter as much as the overarching concept, because we are doing just a preliminary introduction. That the idea is that when you try to apprehend the self, you only see the mixture of these five aggregates. You only see a mixture of the form of material images, your mental tendencies such as opinions, prejudices and ideas, your perceptions, your sensations. But do these together form a self? That is simply a term that we are using as an added concept, as an added idea, apart from this bundle of perceptions. This bundle of perceptions is all that there is. So the self is considered to be non-existent. It's the anatta of the Buddhist thought. So Pratitya Samutpad it arises out of the second and third noble truth, that there are causes of suffering. So the causes were just enumerated as why are we born, why do we desire, etc., 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 going all the way down to ignorance. And when Nagarjuna says that samsara is nirvana, it is to say that Pratitya Samutpad, it shows that by its own understanding, you're able to transcend that cycle that ignorance is able to, that ignorance puts forth. That ignorance forces you to be caught up in the illusory nature of the temporary, the momentary, phenomenal experiences of life. And you also develop this false idea of the self that lies behind all the bundles of perceptions. But what is truly happening is that ignorance is making you cling to the world. It's making you desire. So from the relative point of view, that is samsara. But from the absolute point of view in Mahayana, this distinction between relative and absolute, it's made in Mahayana rather than in Theravada. So from the relative point of view, Pratitya Samutpad shows samsara, the cycle of binding one to the world and the cycle of suffering. But from the point of view of the absolute, so understanding that this binding is something that is simply illusory, that is simply shunya. Shunya is not used in the term of void, but in the term of indescribable. That is neither real nor not real. It's momentary. And since it is momentary, it does not have a real nature to it. But since it arises, there is something real about it. And because of that, it's shunya. It's indescribable. That all phenomena is indescribable. The phenomenal experience of the world is indescribable. And nirvana is something that lies beyond this phenomenal experience. So the paradoxical statement that samsara is nirvana, as Nagarjuna of the Mahayana Madhyamika school would say, That is to say that when we understand the dukkha samudaya, which is that there is a cause of suffering, through that very understanding, we're also able to conclude that there is a cessation of suffering. That if you remove the cause, you remove the effect. So Pratitya Samutpad leads to the belief in anatta, because it is conditional, it shows the conditional nature of the world. It leads to the phenomena, it leads to the concept of what's called Kshana Bhangavad, also called Kshanikvad, which is the momentariness of all phenomena. If everything is conditional, dependent, and momentary, then it's not real. It does not have a permanent self-sustaining inner nature. This conditionality is what defines it. And because it's conditional, it's not real. But since it does arise, there is a reality to it. And that paradox together makes it shunya, as Nagarjuna would describe it. Nagarjuna says that this shunyavad is truly the teaching of the middle path that we mentioned earlier. That the middle path of dukkha, nirodh, gamini, pratipath, that the dukkha or suffering can finally be removed from one's life, and this one is used in a provisional sense. That is by understanding that things hang between, that the phenomenal world hangs between the absolute nothing or nihilistic, or the absolutely existing or the eternalistic permanent. It hangs in the middle of it. That this is how the middle path becomes a deeply philosophical, metaphysical issue in Mahayan Buddhism. Mahayan Buddhism takes the Abhidhamma, the philosophical teachings that had a practical nature to them to help one attain nirvana, and teases out these extremely complicated metaphysical and epistemological conclusions out of them. So when Nagarjuna says that all reality is shunya, what he's saying is that all perceptible reality that is given to the intellect is shunya, because it is neither real, it has svabhav shunya, it has no internal nature to it, it's only conditional, so it's svabhav shunya. But from an absolute point of view, there is no plurality. From an absolute point of view, and this view is very similar to the view of Brahman in Vedantic philosophy. In fact, this Buddhist view of Shunyavad and this Buddhist view of the relative appearance versus the absolutely real, it greatly influenced the Vedantins that came later on. One has to remember that there is an almost 600-year difference between Nagarjuna and Adi Shankara, who compiled, systematized the Advaita Vedanta school in about 8th century CE. Nagarjuna, who compiled and systematized the Madhyamika Shunyavad school in 2nd century CE. And Ashvaghosh was a precursor to Nagarjuna. So it's a school of thought that exists far, far, far before him as well. The view here is that Shunya, or the middle path, is the true teaching of Buddha. That when Buddha is talking about the middle path via Pratitya Samutpad, he is pointing out that there is a relativity, a conditionality in the phenomenal realm, but it is via this very understanding of the samsara. This is the understanding that one can attain via direct experience, via meditation, and by letting go of the clinging of the intellect believing this to be real. The same thing which becomes samsara turns into nirvana. So nirvana in the Theravad school is often just a removal of desire, a blowing out of karma. It's a negative state in a certain sense, where one is able to remove all desire. There's a blowing out of the candle. Of birth, death, and rebirth. But in the Mahayana school, it's much closer to what the later Vedantins make a distinction between the empirical realm and the transcendental realm. But it's done in, of course, a different terminology. It's not talking about a different realm as much as a different way of perceiving the same world that we inhabit. It's not that there is a transcendental realm like the Brahman, but that this very realm is svabhav shunya in terms of our empirical intellectual perception of the world, there is swabhav shunya from the intellectual point of view, but from an experience of the world, when we see the true reality of it, that is prapanch shunya, which is that there is no plurality. If the world was never created and will never cease to exist, then the middle path is one between nihilism and eternalism. That is the paradoxical understanding of Shunyavad that Nagarjuna says is the true essence of Pratitya Samutpad. That the understanding of the arrival of suffering or the creation or the cause-effect relationship of suffering, within that understanding is the undoing of it as well. So understanding samsara is attaining nirvana. So it's not that there is a transcendental realm outside of the empirical realm, but there is a reordering of how we approach the empirical realm. There is a restructuring in our own engagement with the world. That is nirvana. So nirvana is then associated in certain schools as a state that you achieve after your death, in certain interpretations of the Shunyavad school of Nagarjuna, the Madhyamika school, which is the Shunyavad is the tool that they use. Madhyamika is the name of the school. The view is that you're simply reorienting how you engage with the world, and that reorienting itself is nirvana. That it is not a metaphysical state of being after your death, but that reorienting itself is nirvana. And there are different schools that some agree with that position, some don't. The problem with explaining these terms is that for any term that originates, there are hundreds of different interpretations of it. But the three major concepts that the Buddha talks about and how they are taken up in all these different ways are the four noble truths, the second and third noble truth about the arising of suffering and its cessation. They lead to what is called the doctrine of dependent origination, or Pratitya Samutpad. And Pratitya Samutpad, as interpreted by the great logician and systematizer Nagarjuna, it reveals that samsara is nirvana, that it is the reorienting of our engagement with reality that creates nirvana, that creates a sense of peace, because now we are no longer clinging. That we are no longer believing in a certain reality of this world, and we are no longer ignorant about the fact that everything is momentary and conditional when viewed via the intellect. But the intellect is misleading. So nirvana is beyond the four capacities, the four ways of thinking that the intellect has, which is called the Chatushkoti, which we mentioned in the previous sessions too. The Chatushkoti is that we believe via our intellect that something is either real or unreal, or both real and unreal, or neither real nor unreal. But these distinctions do not exist, because when viewed via direct experience, there is no plurality. So the distinction is made between the intellect, what the intellect tries to do when it's apprehending the world. It's still stuck in the machinations of ignorance. But via direct experience, you can find that that is not the case, that not only is there swabhav shunya, which is that there is no inherent truth to things, but there is also prapanch shunya, that there is no plurality. This is explained by Mahayana Buddhists, that this paradox is explained by Mahayana Buddhists by saying that the Buddha did not teach his truth to everyone equally. He taught according to the capacity of his followers. That the Buddhist teachings are always to be qualified in different layers. In the empirical, in the basic layer, they mean this. In the more advanced stage of one's bodhisattvahood, they mean this. And the further up one goes into their realization of truth and removal of ignorance, then finally what one is coming face to face with is that via direct experience there is no plurality. So this notion of absolute flux in reality, that everything is momentary and everything is coming through change, is coming into life and then dissipating, that change is the only reality, that is in fact a lower level teaching. this is what the Mahayana Buddhists will have to say about Pratitya Samutpad, or its corollary, which is Kshanabhangavad, the theory of momentariness. So Buddha's teachings, they begin with these primary three concepts of the Four Noble Truths, the Noble Eightfold Path, and the Pratitya Samutpad, which is the doctrine of dependent origination, which shows that ignorance is that which causes all clinging, all desire, and all suffering. And since everything is momentary, even the self is denied. One of the most unique features of Buddhist metaphysics, that, like David Hume has to say about apprehending the self, that when I try to understand what myself is, I only come across a bundle of perceptions, ideas. I don't see a unified self behind it. This is explained via the five skandhas in Buddhism. The five skandhas being Rupa, Vedana, Samagya, Samskaras, and Vigyan. That they are the form of material images, sensations, perceptions via discrimination, mental tendencies, and consciousness. Then it's these five different layers, these five different aggregates are the only things that we are able to experience when we introspect into the nature of the self. The intellect misleads us into believing that there is a unifying self behind that. It is only these five aggregates. And the desiring, the clinging onto the world and its phenomenal experiences, that is a product of ignorance, the way Maya or Avidya takes place in the Advaita Vedanta school. That ignorance leads us to believe that these things are true, while what is actually going on is that there are these five aggregates that we think form the self, and the self via the intellect believes that the phenomenal world is real. But if, as Pratitya Samutpad will show us, if we see that the world is always conditional, it's always relative, it's always momentary, then the momentariness is both real, since it's that which we get to experience, as well as unreal, because it has no inner nature to it. It has no lasting inherent nature to it. So this is the paradox of Pratitya Samutpad, that samsara is nirvana, as explained by Nagarjuna. That in the very understanding of this momentariness, we are able to understand that the limits of the intellect force us to apprehend reality via the four categories of real, unreal, both real and unreal, or neither real nor unreal. That in fact, via pure experience, we find that this reality, which seems to have constant flux, is one which has no movement at all. It has no plurality whatsoever. And this metaphysics, which resembles the later Advaita Vedanta, is what is the common feature of Mahayana Buddhism. That nirvana is then presented as a state of positive bliss. If you reorient your engagement with the world, you are free from the suffering that desire and ignorance causes. In some schools of thought, this nirvana is actually a state of being that occurs after your death, that you are no longer stuck in the cycle of rebirth, but you attain a certain place of some sort that is beyond the categories of the intellect, but is a positive state of bliss. In some other schools of thought, nirvana is simply a reorientation of how you engage with the world. So you find a great, great diversity, a staggering amount of diversity, in fact, in how these various concepts are apprehended. So as a final recap, you have the Four Noble Truths of suffering. It's how it arises, that by understanding how it arises, you also automatically understand how it ceases to arise. And the path to attain that is the Noble Eightfold Path. The Noble Eightfold Path is one that is already starting a life of experience rather than pure intellectualization. And the doctrine of dependent origination ties all of these things together. The Pratitya Samutpad ties the world of phenomenal experience as well as that which has to be abandoned, the workings of the intellect which have to be abandoned to prioritize direct experience with the world, to understand that samsara is nirvana in that sense, that in the as the philosopher Hegel would say, that the cure is found at the site of the wound. So in a similar sense, it's the reverse engineering of the causal wheel of suffering, that you're able to blow out all the different chains of suffering. And intellect in that will be the misleading feature. It's direct experience. In Mahayana, it's presented through 4 meditations, 3 samadhis, 10 stages of bodhisattvahood. Pure experience is it has an entire complex structure to how one is able to attain that. But that path, that if one is able to put oneself on it, is one in which the intellect is slowly replaced by pure experience. And that is what helps one attain nirvana. So thank you everyone who has been present today. I know this was one of the more abstract and terminology heavy sessions. We can all take a nice big breather now. And I welcome you all to ask me any questions and clarifications. Thank you.
It's good that we're recording the session, because I think I need to watch it 2-3 times before I entirely grasp all these concepts. Yeah.
Tell me about it.
Please, if anyone has any questions, feel free to raise your hand. Yes, sir, Bhagya.
Yes, sir. You told us about the fact that there's a certain philosophy that Buddha did not bestow the same kind of knowledge to every set of people that he preached to. And then on the other hand, we have also discussed that intellect or intellectual understanding is something that should be, perhaps if I can say, that should be looked down upon, because direct experience is what teaches us the most. So how does that distinction take place between a set of people, like that this set of people would be more open to a certain kind of knowledge? Because if the distinctive factor is not intellect, then how does that actually take place? Can we even in the cases of direct experience, should we not comprehend it or understand it with the help of our intellect? And what is that property that actually distinguishes that set of people? What is that capability? What would we call that capability?
That's an excellent question, and it's something that I also grapple with, because this interpretation that Buddha did not teach his teachings equally to everyone, it's a Mahayana interpretation. It's a way of reading through a lot of his words, such as found in the Sutta Pitaka, to find that the more he was around, qualified followers or monks who took their path to attaining nirvana, attaining enlightenment more seriously, he taught them slightly differently the same concept. He would teach them with a little more detail added to it, or a little more complexity added to it. And that is part of the reason that it was believed that he taught people different doctrines according to their capabilities. So for someone who may have a lot of vices, the Buddha may not teach the greater truths towards enlightenment, but may teach things that may make the person's vices be more manageable, and they can put themselves on the path towards bodhisattvahood. And this idea, this interpretation, is not to be found in some of the earlier readers of the Buddha, some of the earlier followers, but this is a Mahayana interpretation, that the Buddha was this great teacher, but also this this person whose enlightenment was not readily available to all. So this may have been an influence of Upanishadic style teachings also, of finding the right student before the true knowledge can be imparted. And how much the intellect can play a role in that. It's the paradox is that you need a certain amount of intellect to see that a certain teaching is worth following. So how the intellect can be looked down upon, I believe the answer to that would be that the intellect does lead you to first understanding its own limits. And if the intellect can understand its limits, that is the right use of intellect.
I just want to address this issue from a different angle, if you allow me to do
so. Yes, sir, of course.
Here, the proposition is this is just an interpretation, or you can say a sort of perspective.
It is.
Why? Because when Gautam Buddha was delivering the so-called lectures or intellects, you can say he was sharing the knowledge with the others. So in two ways, this was happening. One is while moving from one village to another. So he was addressing the mass gatherings, you can say. And there he was... One thing is to sermon, and another thing was giving answers to the questions. So whenever he was receiving the questions, he was answering the questions, and while answering the questions, he was sharing the knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas when he was there in the coterie along with certain number of persons who were more there to take the higher shape, you can say, or to lead the Buddhism from one place to another. So there they have more particular questions because they were reading more. So therefore, when they were reading more, they were addressing more questions. So they were receiving more answers, better interviewed answers than the different crowd. So it will be a case of different crowds. It's a case of giving answers to different questions more. Rather than
contextualized.
Yeah. Exactly. It can be contextualized in this way, but
absolutely.
It's the perspective to pick that he was sharing some with one and some with others. Hmm. I mean, this is just a matter of perspective.
Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely agree. That's exactly the case.
Because if we think from that angle, then another thing is that he had given the higher-ship to Bodhidharma, who was one of the least intellectual among the all. It means who was having the least knowledge.
Yeah.
So he had transferred that higher-ship who had picked it to China. I mean, a sort of perspective only.
Yeah.
And this perspective is more governed by the counter-revolution again, as I was suggesting that there they want to show Hinduism as a unified force, and there any other revolution they had picked in a bit of negative sense.
Yeah. During the Bhakti movement, Buddhism, the Mahayana Buddhism also picked up a lot of elements of deification and glorification of the Buddha like a god-like being with multiple attributes.
Exactly, so, like that becomes a case of Vishnu's avatara and
all. So we find that there is a greater complexity in the interpretation of philosophical elements of Buddhism, but there is also a what seems like a distortion of the very simplistic aspect that it is apprehended by everyone. It's available to everyone. Enlightenment is it's not supposed to be this extremely complicated process that is to be filtered through all these metaphysical layers. That it is one that is to be found by direct experience. So in Mahayana Buddhism and Vajrayana, which is to be found in Tibet, there's a lot of layers put between direct experience and enlightenment or Nirvana. And all of those are these very, very metaphysical and religious sort of splinterings that have been greatly influenced by the Bhakti movement.
Exactly. Even Koan there in China is one of the philosophical understandings where one has to first work on Koan for number of years. So on a single Koan, a person is working for number of years to attain the enlightenment. Now, one more thing is here, and that is that when we talk of Upanishads, when we talk of Vedanta philosophy, we figure it out that non-sharing of information or that exclusion class is mentioned there in the Upanishads or in case of Manusmritis as it is. Whereas in the case of Buddhism, it's not mentioned anywhere. It is just the case of that the person who is actually informing about the Buddhism. So it's just not the case that it is present there in the Buddhism. It is when the third person is speaking about the Buddhism, he is taking a perspective that it is exclusionary in nature or certain persons are being shared. So it means in this way, this is also be termed as it's not part of the philosophy. It is while explaining Buddhism, it has been explained.
It's like if you have part of your teaching in one language and then someone comes and can only speak to you in another language, then if you speak to them in their language, you're not simply saying that I taught them in one way or the other. It's just what the person is able to apprehend.
Yeah, true. Even otherwise, the moment the reader is born, writer is dead.
Yeah.
So I mean, the moment writing is off the now, it's about all about the readers. It is the case with our Indian constitution. So when we pick the constitutionalism as a theory, originalist intent and living tree theories, so we used to do the same thing. If this constitution is now, it has been written in English, we have translated into Hindi, let it be translated into French. There are various words which were not available there in French. So now now you will start reading from the French perspective, it's always going to be different because there are no vocabulary, parallel vocabularies available.
It reminds me of this great quote by the writer Umberto Eco that all translation is negotiation.
Yeah, absolutely right. That fellow is remarkable.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, in fact,
that's really good. I mean, I was having very... After I am reading philosophy in reference to you, I can say in past 3 days, I mean, I start forcing myself to read again the philosophy which I left probably 20 years back. So it's been a good experience for me to again go through, revisit various philosophy. You won't believe that in past 2 to 3 days, I try to recollect many things from various sources. Though I am at home, I am not in a position to access the university as such right now. Right. So whatever sources I have, I'm just trying to collect that. Thanks to this team of NLUD who is sharing the lectures in advance. So unedited version. So I'm going through once through that also. So that to comprehend. And today's lecture, I'm experiencing more comprehensive because of the technical terms you had used. So it will take time to absorb.
Yes, of
but
course.
Thanks once again to you and to this team also.
Thank you so much for your extremely valuable contributions in the discussions also, sir. And I'm thrilled that we've all been able to be a part of this together. It's a deeply satisfying experience for me as well. And I got to learn so much more in the process of presenting it.
Same here. Thanks once again. And thanks to this NLUD team also.
Absolutely.
I mean, this is the first time in interaction with these students. They will interact with me when they will be in fourth year, probably. So thanks to them also.
Right.
Thank you very much, Professor. It's very encouraging to have you participate in these discussions.
Thanks.
I think we have one hand raised, AD.
Yeah.
Good evening, sir. Sorry for asking another question.
Please do. everyone's highly encouraged to ask as many questions as they would desire.
Thank you so much, sir. Yeah. So, sir, of course, as we know that Indian philosophy did not end with Buddhism and there is much more into it. So my question is specifically regarding certain nomad singers in West Bengal or certain fakirs, certain Baul songs, because in their songs, they have such profound stuff that they say, which are even deeper than what is given in maybe the Upanishads and the Vedas. And they are so deep in the riddles, and it is like it is so close, it seems to be so close to the true or absolute knowledge. Mm-hmm. So my question is, how is it that they know so much? How is it did they gain such deep knowledge of the universe? Because they, as much as I know, do not have any formal education, even as of now as they exist. They are still composing songs. How is it that they know so much, and how is it that even after not reading any philosophical books mostly, that they have such a profound knowledge about the universe? And my second question is, could you please clarify or repeat what you said on causality in Charvak school?
Causality in Charvak school, okay, absolutely. To answer your first question, I'm going to give a very unorthodox answer, and that is that I believe, as I'm not entirely sure if someone already said this, but all philosophy is bad poetry. And I believe that since there is a limit to the intellect and what it can do to represent higher truths, there is a greater access that art allows, whether it's through visual arts, whether it's through storytelling or through music, because a lot of these higher truths that Indian philosophy points towards are not to be apprehended via language. They are to be apprehended via a certain experience. And artistic experience is something that has a privileged position in how it can move us in certain directions. Like, to give a slightly different example, the German philosopher Arthur Schopenhauer believed that music dealt with pure forms, because you can experience sadness from music without having any content about what is causing sadness. So there's, or you can experience the happiness without it being about the composer's happiness or any one form of happiness. That art itself has a certain power to move us, and the traditions of the oral traditions that you've spoken of, they may not have, or they may not themselves be readers of these texts, but there is a very rich tradition that dates back hundreds and hundreds of thousands of years. And we must remember that before the texts were written down, they began as an oral tradition. So oral traditions are not, in fact, secondary in any way. They are very, very rich traditions that can often convey the deepest teachings without even having read a single text. And the other question about causality in Charvak, well, I want to first reiterate that causality is something that is that we find absent in Charvak epistemology simply because we do not have texts on Charvak epistemology. But causality is something that is problematized because inference is problematized. So if to use David Hume's example, who is a very famous problematizer of our typical understanding of causality, if you take two billiard balls and you hit one and it hits the other one and they move in certain directions, then David Hume would say that what you are only seeing is the connection between two events. There is no causal relationship between the two. The causal relationship is inferred. And that inference or anuman, that is what is problematized or that is what is rejected by the Charvaks. They say that for David Hume, it's a much, much different, more, it's a longer story because, you know, we have his texts, we have his work, but I'm not going to go into that right now. For the Charvaks, the inference is that you only see two things happening at the same time. But whenever you say that this is the case and this always happens, that is an inference you are making. You're jumping from the scene via perception to the general, which you can only say if you encounter an infinite or comprehensive amount of those two events taking place. So, for example, the syllogism that Socrates is a man, all men are mortal, therefore Socrates is mortal. They would say that the Charvakins would say that this cannot be proven because you have not encountered all men. You have inferred via inductive reasoning that all men are mortal, but the only thing that you can know for sure is Socrates is a man because that is what is given to you by pratyaksh, via your perception. So anything where inference is involved, it involves inductive reasoning or deductive reasoning. These are matters of logic. Deductive reasoning is considered to be circular reasoning. I won't go into that right now, but inductive reasoning is something like I observe 100 white swan and I say that all swan are white. This is clearly not true because black swan are available. If I say most swan are white, then the number most is a relative number. Like if I've seen 100 swan, but 1,000 swan exist in my city, then I've only seen a small number of them. So how can I even say that most swan are white? So anything where you're inferring and making a general claim, the Charvakins would say that no, all you have is pratyaksh. The inference is a leap in the dark that you're making. Even saying something like all men are mortal, unless you have seen every man and confirmed that they're mortal, you cannot even make that statement. All you have is pratyaksh. So that is why inference and causality are both problematized.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Vaishnavi?
Am I audible?
Yes, absolutely.
So I was asking that can we attribute the limited spread of Charvak school of thought to the lack of storytelling culture present that I'm aware of?
Some of these questions are taken up. I'm sorry to interrupt you. I just wanted to quickly just mention the name of that book once again. It's called The Studies on the Charvak and Lokayata by Ramakrishna Bhattacharya. So he answers a lot of these questions about why the Charvak school never became popular, why it was misrepresented. A lot of these historical factors that led to its disappearance are taken up in that book. But what we basically suffer from is a lack of resources. So all we can do is speculate that they didn't form a religion. That could be a reason. There wasn't an oral tradition of them. That could be a reason. They were not popular enough amongst the common people. That could be a reason. You know, there could be many, many reasons.
Okay, so it's like we can only speculate at this point.
We can only speculate.
I asked this because I read somewhere that human imagination has contributed to many religion spreading, school of thought spreading, and evolution of humankind. That's why.
Yeah, and it's also, if you think about how non-comforting the Charvak worldview is. It doesn't believe in life after death. It doesn't believe in karma. You know, one can say that the karma theory, if one reads it from a critical speculative lens, one can say that the belief in karma is reduced to the human inability to accept that actions may not have consequences apart from their immediate consequences. That someone can do you wrong and nothing wrong may happen to them as a result. That very concept is so uncomfortable to us that we create this entire theory of karma to accommodate moral causation. That there is no such thing as moral causation, there is only physical causation. So in a sense, the Charvak school is very bleak, because it doesn't give a lot of these crutches that one can lean on to accommodate themselves to the sufferings of the world.
Even otherwise, as is the case with Buddhist tradition or with Jainism also, that when they want to out of the clutches of a strict bracket formula, which was provided by the Upanishads, it was essential, because the moment how or why I'm going to carry within a religion, if it will be told to me that you have to follow karma, it means wherever you are placed within the Varna system, you have to follow that, otherwise you are going to face the music. So if this is the case, you are going to follow that, then you cannot ever will come out of that bracket at all. Whereas by following Charvaka philosophy, they were in a position to at least live their life. And when there is no life after the life, then in that case, whatever you have to do here. So it will make you more ethically vigilant rather than make you vandal. I mean, it is not that it will make you more a criminal, but rather it will create more ethical exercises within you, because you don't have to go anywhere. You don't have to rely on anyone. And you have to do everything ethically by your own.
Absolutely. It's from the to borrow a term by Jean-Paul Sartre, it's something that condemns you to be free. And because of that, there's a great deal of responsibility, personal responsibility, that also comes in from that freedom.
And this is what the case with Christopher Hitchens also. I mean, I'm not going to pick him only because then it will be entering into some other domain only.
Yeah.
So Richard Dawkins and Christopher Hitchens, I'm not picking. But yes, this is the case. It will make you more ethical.
Yeah,
you will be more responsible. Yes,
it definitely puts a premium on responsibility, because there is that lack of dogmatic structure from which you derive your worldviews.
True. Even I want to add to the previous question also, when we were discussing about that why it is that the Bullas and others are who are less literate than others have attained. So one thing is that there is a tradition of transferring the knowledge via oral. I mean, but there is another thing, and that is therefore we had seen in case of Buddhism also, that Bodhidharma was just a Khan Sama. He used to cook, and he was generally not used to hear to what Buddha is speaking. But when it comes to answering his very important question, when it's about transferring the hardship, he was silent. And that silence had made him taken the, that hardship from Buddha and a relevant person. And so similar is the case with Bulla also. Bulla Shah was also a sort of, he was a servant to a master, and then one day he had attained the... So idea was that knowledge is not going to provide you anything. Attainment can happen anywhere. Therefore, Bodhidharma, when he had transferred Buddhism to China, so in China, there are various schools which are completely different. So they are not there to teach you anything. They will teach you to live in experience. So therefore, there we have identified much religious philosopher in Indian context, as we used to say, but those philosophers who are not read, but they had experienced the life. So therefore, attaining enlightenment through experience becomes the task, and which is not the case in India, where we had given birth to Buddhism, but then we start following Buddhism until we had start experiencing it. So we had not start experiencing it, we had start reading it. So reading and experience made a difference. So Bulla was an experiential. Lala in the context of Jammu and Kashmir publishing was from there. So she was in experience. So it means the moment it will be a case of experience, as we are keeping again with the contemporary Derrida. So he is in the post-modernist sense, again talking of the experience only, from where we have picked this subaltern philosophy also that had picked in India. So Gayatri Sipiwak and all in Indian context had picked that area of human experience. So therefore, we are now following the human experience. Therefore, in modern context, you had seen various philosophers who are not read in that way, but their experiences speak.
Right. And the readership of philosophy is always an afterthought to the complexity of lived experience.
Yeah, true. I agree.
Do we have any further questions? We are almost pressed for time. So if there are any questions, we'll be ready to take a final one. Otherwise, I think we have come to the end of our lecture series. Thank you, Asad, for doing this. I think Vaishnavi has a question.
Right.
I was just asking about the reading list. I think someone also mentioned it earlier.
We'll be sending that reading list along with today's recording on the mailing list. So please check your mail at somewhere around 8:30. Hmm. Yeah.
And okay, one more thing. But this is to NLUD Philosophy Club. Before posting this on internet on your channel, please do necessary additions. And wherever necessary, edit my answerings and my comments and observations also. Asad is politically correct, but my questioning was most politically correct. I want that it must be subject to some sort of addition. So don't put it straight away. I don't want that thing should directly happen to my email account.
Professor, we'll consult you with respect to the editing part. I'll write you a mail after the meeting.
Sure.
Very important point.
Yeah.
At times.
In the present tense, we have to be politically correct.
We absolutely have to. Thank you so much, everyone, thanks, for being present. Thank you so much, sir, for your valuable contributions every time. And NLUD Delhi, the Philosophy Club, I owe you a debt of gratitude for letting me be part of such a wonderful experience.
Oh, pleasure is ours, totally, Asad. It was wonderful to host you and everyone who attended for these past 3 days. It is the most momentous thing that our club has done ever since it came into existence.
Oh, wow. What an honor. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much.
Hi, everyone.
All the recordings, I think the final edited versions of the recording will be uploaded in 2 to 3 days. As usual, we'll be sending a pre-edited recording to all the attendees on the mail, as well as a reading list. And also, in addition to the reading list, I'd also like to ask the Peter Adamson podcast on Indian philosophy. Mm. That is also a very good resource. Mm-hmm. If any of you like to, if any of you prefer the audio format more than reading, which is something that I do because that gives me the time to do other things while I listen to podcasts, which is something really great. And thank you everyone for attending. I would like to bid everyone a goodbye and a very nice evening. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Bye.
Thanks. See you. Bye-bye.
See you, everyone. Bye.